I work for a company called Sys11, which is a managed hosting company from Berlin. We offer infrastructure as a service and managed Kubernetes. And this talk is about getting started with Kubernetes. Kubernetes is a container orchestration platform. That means it helps you to deploy, run, and scale your services in isolated containers. It is very powerful and has a large community behind it, with lots of large companies backing it. Google, where the project originally came from, but also Microsoft, Red Hat, and lots of other small companies contributing to it, which makes it one of the largest open source projects on GitHub. The good thing about Kubernetes is that it helps you, if you want to run your services and applications in the cloud somewhere, that it helps you to have no vendor lock-in, or as little vendor lock-in as possible. Because Kubernetes itself runs on your laptop, because it's already included in Docker Desktop clients, for example, where you can just activate it in the Docker Desktop client. It runs on your bare metal infrastructure in your own data center, as well as on multiple cloud providers like AWS, Azure, Google Cloud Platform, where you can just boot up VMs and install Kubernetes on there. And even if you don't want to install it yourself, because installing Kubernetes is okay-ish nowadays, upgrading it is hard and making it highly available is even harder, you can also just buy it, rent it as in a managed way. For example, again, from Google, with the Google Kubernetes Engine, with Amazon EKS, or also for the company I'm working for, which is Sys11 Metacube. The good thing, if you buy it managed, it's easy to upgrade, usually with one click somewhere. It's easy to scale because you can just boot up new worker nodes to your Kubernetes cluster. And also, for example, we monitor clusters for you and ensure that it's working and tell you if something is wrong. Also, you get features like load balancing, distributed persistent storage that don't come with Kubernetes out of the box already included, or things like backups or premium support. But this talk is about how to use Kubernetes and not how to set it up, because that would probably be a workshop of 6 hours. When you use Kubernetes, you also have like a slight learning curve. And this talk is about to get you started with that. So I'm going to explain some of the Kubernetes basics. And then I'll do some live demo where I deploy a simple PHP web application to a Kubernetes cluster, which hopefully is going to work, and then cover some internals about how Kubernetes does things so you get a better understanding of why things are the way they are in Kubernetes. But first, let's talk quickly about why do you actually want to run things in containers. As I said, Kubernetes is a container orchestration platform, so it helps you run things, containers, on infrastructure. The good thing about running things in containers instead of just having like a server where you provision with Puppet or Chef or Ansible some PHP and then some Nginx and have it run there and deploy your software with rsync is that it helps you to run your services in isolation from each other much better. And running things in isolation means that everything that is needed for your service and application to run should be included in one image that you can just put anywhere, and without any much more dependencies but the container runtime, you can just run your service. And this helps you, in organization-wise, to decouple ops from dev in a more natural way. I know like the buzzword is DevOps to combine this, but in reality, oftentimes there are like ops people in a company who are really good at managing databases, at setting up servers, about provisioning them, but then they also have to care about all the things that the developers want, because the developer wants now a new PHP version, and then they have to roll it out to some servers, and then you have to synchronize deployment of the code that uses a new PHP version that has some changes and patches because of BC breaks in it, together with like some Puppet rollouts, which is all kind of weird. With containers, that allows organization to say, okay, there is an ops department who's there to put servers into place, make them ready to run containers, which means usually installing Docker in it or installing a Kubernetes cluster, and maybe managing all the databases and storage systems that developers need. And then the developer or the development team can say, okay, I have now a PHP application, or I have a Java application or a Node.js application, and I'm not only developing the code, I'm also providing an image that has the exact tested PHP version that I need in it. And you build this into an image, roll it out to all the servers, and if you want to upgrade, the PHP version, this is like one process. So it makes things easier to deploy, because deployment means putting an image somewhere and starting it. It makes it easier to upgrade system dependencies, as I just said. And also, by that, it makes it easier to scale things, because if I need more computational power for one service, instead of having to go to my operation and saying, oh, for this service that needs PHP and that and that and that, I need like three more servers. And then someone says, oh, yeah, then we have to run Puppet on there, add roles to the servers, and this is going to take probably a week. You have already like the base server that just has Docker or Kubernetes on it, and you can roll it out on your own and just say, okay, as long as I have the computational power in my data center, I can just scale it up. Also, by that, it makes it easier to develop things, because the same container image that I can run in my data center, I can also run locally on my laptop, which ensures I have the exact same environment. Now we can say, okay, all these benefits I can also just have with virtual machines. Infrastructure as a service on AWS, if I just click, I can also get new virtual machines. And yeah, of course, they maybe need a bit more time to provision with Chef or Puppet, but it's also fine. The one thing about containers is also that it offers a bit of better performance, because a container is not a virtual machine. A container just means the processes still run natively on the systems. They just have an encapsulated file system on their own, and their own port and network space and their own process space. And when we're talking about containers, oftentimes, or usually we mean Docker containers, though there are also other container technologies. A Docker container, or Docker image, is built from a Docker file. And this is just like a very short recap. This is not like a Docker talk, just because I'm going to show some Docker files later. This is like one example where we have like a very simplified PHP application. We are basing this on an image that already someone else built, which includes PHP and Apache. Then we can define a working directory. We can install some packages. So we have a Debian image as a base here at some point in the end where we can install curl. We can set environment variables that are then later there when the process starts and they're available for it. We can then copy some source code from the directory with the Docker files into the image. We can expose ports. And we can define an entry point, which defines a process that is ran when the Docker image started from this, or the container started from this image. If I have this file, I can build it into an image just with Docker build, and I give it like a name. You're going to see this later in the demo as well. And then also, if I want to test this locally, I can just run it by saying Docker run, giving it the name that I just created. And with this pflag, I'm saying, OK, the port 80 from within the image should be mapped to the port 8080 on my local machine so I can actually test it. And what Kubernetes does in the end, it helps you doing this Docker run somewhere on some service. And a couple things more, like deployment, scaling, monitoring. So if you say now, salt containers are a great tool, how can we use them in Kubernetes? For that, let's define some core concept and terminology first, so that you know what I'm talking about in the demo and can follow it. In Kubernetes, all the servers that you have are called cluster. So if you have 20 servers where you all install Kubernetes on, this forms a Kubernetes cluster. On the small level, you have the Docker image. You already saw this with Docker build from a Docker file and some source code, I create an image. If you start the image, and the image contains everything that the service needs to run. So the PHP version, the source code, all kinds of libraries that you need, and so on. If you start an image, it's run inside of a container. A container can only run one process, and of course, this process can have subprocesses. In normal applications, or in a lot of applications, if you want to have one instance of an application, having one process is not enough. Because, for example, in PHP, usually to make your application really work, you have at least Nginx and PHP FBM, for example. And maybe also a database router, a monitoring daemon, whatever. Of course, you could say now, okay, let's create one big image which includes everything and then have something like SupervisorD to start all the processes and manage them. But then you're basically having a process management tool or container management tool like Kubernetes that basically just manages one SupervisorD. So it defeats kind of the purpose. Also, these images get really large, and upgrading dependencies is also harder because maybe you want to go upgrade PHP that depends on some library or some package, and Nginx depends on the same package but in another version, and then you have version conflicts, and this all can get very messy. So that's why in Kubernetes you have the concept of a pod. A pod is a group of one or more containers which share the same pod space. But they don't share the same process space, so every container within a pod, it looks like they are on their own. There's only one process running in that. Also, their file system is not shared, but the pod space in the network is shared. That means if I want to communicate from the Nginx container that I have to the PHP FPM container in the same pod, it just behaves like it's on localhost. So what you can think about as an analogy is, in a traditional setup, a pod would be one server that you can then easily scale. And scaling in Kubernetes of pods you do with a thing called a replica set. In a replica set, you define how many instances of a pod you want to have in a container. So in this case, I have this green replica set and have three instances of my pod, which each have two containers. A replica set is tied to a very specific version of containers. So for example, for the image version of the PHP image that I have, 5, and the Nginx image version, 3. And then the replica set ensures that these image versions of the containers are there. If I want to do a rolling update, Kubernetes has the concept of a deployment, which basically updates version of this replica sets. And by default, it's doing it in a rolling way, so that it ensures that my service is, during the deployment, up and running all the time. Of course, this only works if I have more than one replica. If I have only one instance of the pod running, then you can't do a rolling deployment. You can also configure this very heavily, so if you want to have other deployment strategies, this is also possible. Communication-wise, by default, you can communicate within a pod on all ports, but no port is exposed to the outside or accessible from the outside. And this also includes other services running within Kubernetes, other pods that are running in Kubernetes. If you want to expose, for example, of the Nginx port 80 to be used by some other things running in Kubernetes, you would have to define a service. And with a service, this is like this box here, you can say, okay, port 80 of the Nginx pods should be available to the outside. I'll explain a bit later how this works internally. A service makes the pod only available to other things running within Kubernetes. In order to make it available to really the outside, so that I can use it from my laptop, I have to define an ingress resource. With that, I get a domain name, and this is then routed over an Nginx, usually, or some other web service, to the actual instances of the pod that are available and running. So this is kind of like with a service and an ingress, you have kind of a load balancing setup directly built within Kubernetes. Servers in Kubernetes are called nodes. These are just the physical servers. And usually, you don't care about where your containers are running on which node. Kubernetes automatically decides, based on requests and limits for CPU and memory, you can put on a container where to run your containers. And it makes sensible decisions that, for example, if you have three nodes and you want to have three replicas of one container, that it will distribute them over the three nodes to ensure that if one node goes down, the service is still up and running. And if one node goes down, it will also redistribute the containers that were running on this node to other nodes. Earlier I said, Docker image should have everything included that the service needs to run. That is actually not completely true because there's one exception. A Docker image should not include configuration. Because if it included configuration, you would need to build an image for dev one for staging, one for production, that all have the same source code, but with different configurations because of different URLs, IP addresses, credentials, and so on. Every Docker image is usually quite large because it contains PHP, all the libraries, and so on. So it can quickly be like a few hundred megabytes. If you then exploit this, having this for different environments, that can become quite tedious. So a good practice is to have the configuration injected into the container. In Kubernetes, you can put your configuration in a config map, which is a key value store. And then you can use the data from this config map inside of your running containers by either mounting the config map as a volume, which creates files in the file system that has the content of this config map, or through environment variables. Also, more details to this later. And then last, you have the concept of namespaces in Kubernetes, where you can, namespaces are just a way to close off or namespace deployments and containers that you have in a way. For example, you could say every team has their own namespace. If the team is not there anymore on a staging system, you can just delete the whole namespace, which just deletes then all the containers that they ever created for staging environments. That could be nice, for example. If you interact with Kubernetes, in Kubernetes, everything that I just said is a resource. So Kubernetes has a very restful way of interacting with it. So a namespace is a resource, a deployment is a resource, a pod is a resource. And you interact with Kubernetes by creating, receiving, updating, and deleting these resources. And then Kubernetes internally, it has controllers that listen on these events that then put the whole cluster in a state that is matching the resources you created and defined. So it's a bit of a declarative way of working. For example, if I want to have a deployment, which I can do rolling updates on, this is the deployment resource. Usually it's defined in YAML. You can also define it in JSON. So you have a deployment, you give it a name, and then you say with a list how many containers you want to have in this deployment in this pod. So in this case, I just have one, Symfony Demo. The image is Symfony Demo 1.1.0, and I'm exposing here the pod 80. This is very abbreviated. And then I could either make an HTTP call to the Kubernetes REST API or just use the command line tool kubectl to apply this YAML file to the cluster, which kubectl also will just do a post request to the Kubernetes cluster API. And after I did this, I can say kubectl get deployments. I have my deployment then in here. I can also just fetch one deployment, which would be get request to deployments / symfony demo. I can then also get the YAML definition back if I'm interested in it. I can delete it, and I can also edit it. So let's look at a more practical example. So this is now the live demo part of the presentation. And to prepare a live demo, first we need a Kubernetes cluster. And since I don't want to set up like a Kubernetes cluster, I just took the managed thing here and just like a short 15-something seconds of advertisement. That is how easy you can set up Kubernetes clusters on our product. Having said that, it's also as easy to do this on Google Cloud or Amazon because it's also just a few clicks where you provide, like, in this case, your OpenStack username. You decide what kind, how many nodes you want to have, what size they should be. You define SSH key, and then you click Next. You click Create, and then it takes a couple of minutes to boot up all the VMs. And since I didn't want to wait in the screencast for it, that's how it looks like in the end. So that's how it works for us and all other managed providers. And this is nice to get started. Then next thing we install for this demo in a Kubernetes cluster is Helm. Helm is a package manager for Kubernetes, something like Composer for Kubernetes. And with Helm, you can basically say something like, first of all, Helm install WordPress, and it installs WordPress with MySQL and everything running. To install Helm, we can install the Helm CLI client with Homebrew or another package manager, and just say Helm init, and it will install Helm into our Kubernetes cluster. And what we then, for example, do for load balancing, we can create an Nginx ingress controller and install it with Helm, which will get traffic from the outside, route it to our pods. You'll see this in a bit, just with Helm install Nginx Ingress. Because we want to be secure, I also wanted to have TLS certificates. So there is a project called Cert Manager that automatically, for domain names that I define, requests TLS certificates from Let's Encrypt. And we can install it with Helm install Cert Manager. And then the only thing left that I have prepared already is I added a cluster issue resource that comes with the Cert Manager, where I basically just say the Cert Manager on which API endpoint to fetch the Let's Encrypt certificates from and what my email address is to create them. And this is also just a resource of the type cluster issue, which I then can apply to my cluster and create in my cluster with kubectl apply. So let's deploy the Symfony demo app now to Kubernetes. The Symfony demo app is here, just a demo app on GitHub. And let's see that everything works. So perfect. So I have it already just running here. Okay, still works. Cool. So I have a Kubernetes cluster here. You can see I have three nodes running since 7 days. They're on the current Kubernetes version. And what you also can see already, I have one pod already running because I already deployed it once, the Symfony demo pod. And I also have, I also have one deployment, a Symfony demo deployment, where the desired state is to have one instance, the current state is one instance, so everything is available. Great. The first thing I'm going to do is so this is the source code of the Symfony demo application, and since this takes a couple of seconds to just show you that deployments are working, I'm going to say, add here something to my template of the homepage, and then I'm just gonna build a new version of the image. So this is gonna take a few seconds. Oh, it's already finished. Then also something that has network in it, let's directly push it to the Docker registry so that my Kubernetes cluster can use it later on. In the meantime, I want to show you first the Docker file that I'm using here, because this is quite interesting. The Symfony demo app has not only PHP code, but also JavaScript code included. And I'm using then here in my, to keep the Docker image as small as possible, a feature called multi-stage builds in Docker, which means I have different stages for my image creation. The first one is this here, which is based on an image that already has Node.js and Yarn, like a Node.js package manager that the Symfony demo app is using, included. And from my directory here that I'm in, I'm just copying the package.json and Yarn log file into the container. Then I'm running Yarn install. Then I'm copying the Webpack configuration, which is used for building all the JavaScript and CSS files into like one bundled JavaScript file that browsers can understand. And then I'm copying all the JavaScript and CSS assets into the image. And then I'm saying, OK, Yarn run build. The reason why I'm not just saying, oh, copy everything, but just copying the files that I need is that Docker has a caching mechanism included. And Docker will recognize if this package.json file hasn't changed and this yarn log file hasn't changed, and based on these files, it already ran yarn install, that it doesn't need to run yarn install because the files haven't changed. Same, if none of my CSS and JavaScript files change, it also doesn't need to run yarn run build anymore because nothing has changed. If I would copy just all the files in there all the time, and I just added one PHP file, it will say, oh, yeah, one of the files changed, so I have to run everything again, which will take a couple minutes sometimes. That's also why the build, Docker build was so fast, because everything was cached already. The same thing with the second stage, where I'm using the Composer image, and I'm just copying the Composer log and JSON file into here, and run Composer install to get my vendor directory. So I have now two images, one image from here that contains all the build JavaScript and CSS files that I need, and one that contains the render directory from Composer. And the last image is the actual image that I use for running the service later on, which is based on the 7.2 Apache image. I'm installing all the libraries and packages that Symfony need. I'm installing all the PHP extensions that Symfony need. I'm copying in an Apache configuration for Symfony like it needs it. And then the interesting part is here, I can do from the image, from the yarn build image, I'm just copying the build JavaScript and CSS file into my new third image. From the composer image, I'm copying the vendor directory, and then I'm copying the rest of the files. So if only a PHP file changed, only this will be executed, and this will be executed where I say, yeah, the directory where the cache and log things are written to should be writable by the 3W data user. So we have now the build image. And now we have to tell Kubernetes that it should update the image, because we have, if we look at the deployment that I have here, Symfony demo, and look at the YAML definition in the cluster, you're going to see like lots of things. They're not that important, but the important thing is here, there is the image with the version in there. So I have this file here, and I'm just going to update the version to the one that I just built. And then I'm going to say kubectl apply dash f with this file. Then it will see, OK, the deployment is newly configured. There's also a service and an ingress resource in there. I'll show this in a second. I hope. OK, I have only one replica, so the rolling deployment doesn't work. Let's see. It's still downloading the image. While it's downloading, let's have a look again at this YAML file. So I have a deployment, which gives a name. And then I have one container in this pod of this deployment, which just has the Symfony demo image in here. And then I defined a liveness probe and a readiness probe for health checks. So what Kubernetes is going to do is first, when the image is container started from this image, it will check the container will not be available for to be routed traffic to as long as this readiness probe is not ready and returned like a 200 once. And then it will execute continuously this liveness probe as a health check to see if it's still running. And if, as soon as one of these, the liveness probe then fails, it will say, oh, this container is not being able to receive traffic anymore, so it will restart it or route traffic to other pods that are still up and running. Let's see. Yeah, here my container is now up and running. So, yay. Very small here is Hello Dresden. So the deployment worked. Let's look at the other things I'm defining in this file. I'm also defining a service resource here where I'm saying, OK, I want to define a service called Symfony demo, and where I'm just exposing the port 80 of the pod with the selector Symfony demo, which matches to this label here. So this way, I'm exposing port 80 of Apache. And then I have an ingress resource where I give this nice URL that I can reach from the outside. I'm saying this URL should be matched to the service name Symfony demo to port 80, which matches the service I'm defining up here. And I'm also saying, hey, I want to have a TLS certificate for it with the cluster issuer I just showed a couple slides earlier, which gives me like a nice URL here with a TLS certificate. Another thing I want to show you is backup and restore. Because this is also something that I have included, and this is quite nice to show. So I have now like one pod here, right? And what I wanted was a tool called ARC, which is a backup utility for Kubernetes, and I already installed it in my cluster. I want to create now a backup from this default namespace where the Symfony demo application is running in. And this will create a backup from the state of my cluster, so what is running in there, what deployments, what pods, and also, if I want to, of any kind of data that have that I have stored in volumes. Let's see. Yeah, the backup is completed. And now I'm just going to delete the deployment. Accidentally. You see the pod is currently terminating. That should be, yeah. So now I have no pod running anymore. If I go back to my browser, you also see, yeah, there's a 503 because the URL is not valid anymore. So what I can now do, I can say arc backup, arc restore, create from the backup I just created. And now, hopefully, yeah. So you see the pod is going to be started again. And also, if I had data in there with volume data that is written, for example, for a database or log files or so, that also would be restored out of the backup. And now it's running also with the same version here again. OK, so much for the demo. Let's go back to the slides. So we saw a Docker file where we copied our code as a small recap to this Docker file. We built the project running Composer install, Yarn install, Yarn run build. We looked at multi-stage builds to make build times shorter and Docker images smaller. We then built the image with Docker build. We told Kubernetes how to do with this image with a resource defined in YAML or JSON. We had the deployment here, a bit abbreviated with the image version down there. We saw aliveness and readiness probe. Actually, in a deployment, there are lots of more configurations available. So you can do things like set environment variables from there, mount volumes for persistent storage, request resource limits for CPU and memory, define upgrades and strategies for the deployment. You can override everything you define in Docker file, for example, the command or the entry point that is executed to execute different processes. You can configure the scheduler to do different things, saying, hey, I have special kind of nodes where this put should never run on, or the other way around. You can listen on lifecycle events. You can reduce container capabilities to make it more secure, and lots more. We saw that we exposed our application with a service resource to other things running in Kubernetes, and we defined an ingress resource with TLS. We created everything with kubectl apply, and we had the application in there, and we did a rolling deployment by changing the version and saying kubectl apply again. And we saw backup and restore with Arc. Yeah, and we had the demo. There are actually more things that you can deploy in Kubernetes, not just these deployments with rolling updates. One nice thing I like are cron jobs. Who of you had the problem that they have in the company, like one host to run all the cron jobs that has one big cron tab, and then the host at some point was away? OK, this is like a third that had this already. And then you have to provision a server. The cron jobs are not running. You're not sure which state it was, what ran when. And this is like a whole huge mess. The nice thing about cron jobs in Kubernetes is it's, of course, there for, to run regularly repeating jobs. That you just define a cron job resource in Kubernetes saying, hey, this is my cron schedule, like in a cron tab, and then which process in which container is going to be run. Very similar to deployments. And then Kubernetes on its own will figure out every time the schedule is there, the time of the schedule is there, where there is space to run this container and run it just on one any server available. And the only way how to lose this information somehow, which cron jobs are there to run, is if the whole Kubernetes cluster is away. So it's much more resilient. There's also concept of daemon sets to run something on every worker node automatically, stateful sets if you have things like databases where you need to run one instance of a container that is a master first and then the slaves afterwards, and also third-party operators that help you with complex setups. Third-party operators could be, for example, a MySQL master-master-slave setup, multi-master-slave setup, where you can just say, hey, create me a complete MySQL cluster, and then someone that figured all these hard parts out to do how to do multi-master-slave setups in MySQL, that wrote a lot of code for that, will into this operator will just create this. Let's look a bit more on how Kubernetes does things internally. And one thing I want to talk about a bit more is service discovery. I said earlier, within a pod, everything behaves like localhost because we have a shared port namespace, but not a shared file system, and a separate process space. So everything is network-wise like localhost. Between pods, you have to expose pods with services. Again, this would be where I'm exposing the pod called Symfony Demo in a service called Symfony Demo and expose the port 80. If I create such a service resource, Kubernetes will create a virtual IP address for the service. So every service has a virtual IP address. If I say kubectl get service and then the name of the service, I actually can see this internal IP address. This is not an IP address that I can reach from the outside. It's just in the internal network. But the good thing is, this virtual IP address, I can just send requests to. And then Kubernetes will automatically, with IP table routes, load balance to all the pods that are available for the service. And if one of them goes down, it will remove it. And I can discover this IP address in other containers by either environment variables, because every other container in Kubernetes will get an environment variable automatically injected that is looking like this, the name of the service, and then host and port, which gives me then the IP address. Also, this IP address is stable, so it will not change. Even if I scale up and down containers, they also have IP addresses, but they will change all the time. Or I can even more easily discover this with DNS. So Kubernetes includes a DNS service internally, and I can just, the DNS name is the name of the service, so I can just look up the IP address with NSLookup or any other DNS tool, which means in the end, I can just do an HTTP request to HTTP Symfony Demo, and I will reach one of the pods serving the service. Alternatively, so this is like the default case of what I usually do. Alternatively, I can make the container part of the host network. Kubernetes has its own virtual network where all the pods and containers are in to make it not accessible from the outside, as like a nice thing. I could also make it part of the container of the host network. Of course, then I have to care about port conflicts because on every worker node, I only can expose port 80 once. If I have two ports, two different applications that both serve traffic on port 80, this whole host network thing doesn't work anymore. So it's just something for very specific cases. There is also a service type load balancer. So at the service resource, I could add a type load balancer, which also then gets an external IP for the service. And we can define an ingress, as you saw earlier, that gives us a nice domain name, a public domain name that is routable by an ingress controller. What about data storage? Because from what you just saw in the demo, it's just like a stateless Symfony Demo application. There's no database involved. Yeah, there are log files written, but yeah, it doesn't matter. Because we have every container has its own file system, it means if the container is stopped or killed or deleted or something, the whole file system of the container is also deleted. So if I write something into the file system, fine, that works. I can also read it out, but it goes away as soon as the container, if the pod or the container is scheduled somewhere else. So if I want to have persistent storage, I have to mount volumes into my containers. A lot of documentation there is in the Kubernetes doku, which is quite good. I'll give you like a short introduction into it. The syntax, how to mount a volume inside of a pod or a deployment is like this. I can, in my definition, where I have all the containers next to it, I can define volumes. There are different type of volumes, persistent volumes, and also very unpersistent volumes. This empty dir type is just like a directory that also is going to go away when the pod is rescheduled. So it's maybe they are good for caching or sharing data between different containers in the same pod. But it's the shortest example, so I put it on here. So I'm defining a volume. I'm giving it a name. And then I can, in a container of this pod, mount this volume into a directory. Again, this is not persistent. If I want to have it persistent, I have to define a persistent volume that or storage class. That could be, depending on the provider, NFS or anything else. On managed providers, you usually have a distributed persistent storage volume thing, network storage volume thing already. It depends a bit on your Kubernetes setup. So just to show you how you would do this on our managed Kubernetes or on Google, you can specify a persistent volume claim, which looks like this. For example, here I'm giving it a name again, and I'm saying from a storage class, which could be, that depends on the provider. It could be just generic or any kind of other things. I just want to have a read-write once volume, and I want to have 10 gigabytes of storage. And if you have enough quota at your cloud provider, you will get this. And this persistent volume claim, you can mount then also into a volume in a container by saying, okay, instead of having MTD here, I'm referencing a persistent volume claim with the name that you just saw. And I abbreviated this, but you mount it the same way as you saw before, where you say, okay, I have volume mounts in here that mount this volume called PostgreSQL data into a file, into a folder, into the container. More on that on this page here. Another type of storage is configuration. I shortly said this in the beginning. Configuration should not be included in the Docker image directly, but injected from the outside. And the way to do this in Kubernetes is with config maps. Config maps are a key value store. And in the end, also just a resource within Kubernetes. So that means there is a YAML behind that. And this looks like this. So have a config map. I'm giving it a name. And then the data is just the key value data that I can use then in containers. And I can access this config map and kind of mount it into my pod through environment variables. So I have here, again, a list of containers. And I can just say, OK, I want to set an environment variable called special key. And the value should come from the config map named special config. And I should take the value out of this config map of the key special key. Of course, if I have 50 of those key value things in a config map, that can be become kind of tedious to write. So I can also do this much shorter. I can say the environment should come from this config map special config. And then for every key, there's going to be an environment variable created with the value out of the config map. The other possibility is, if I don't like environment variables, I can also access these config map data through a volume. So in my pod here, I can define a volume. And instead of having empty dir or persistent volume claim, I'm saying, OK, the data should come from a config map. This is a name. I'm giving the volume a name. And then the same way as before, I can mount this config volume here inside of, for example, etc config. And then for every key in my config map, I'm going to have a file. And the content of the file is the value of this key in a config map. Again, if you want to have more information on that, there is good documentation on the Kubernetes website. And there is also a special kind of config maps called secrets that are there for, to store sensitive information, like passwords, for example. They work the same way as config maps, just instead of saying I'm referencing a config map, you say I'm referencing a secret. And then depending on your Kubernetes installation, a secret may be just base64 encoded, so very secret. Or there's actually some more secure storage behind it. So for example, you could hook up HashiCorp Vault to it, that all the secrets are stored in there. And then with permission roles, you could say only specific people and specific services are being able to access, for example, my database password. More information on that. And another thing, I said Kubernetes is very good at scaling, and then I also want to show that you that in a demo, and this is, I'm really not unsure if that's going to work. So the first thing is going to work, it's easy, because it's manual scaling. Because you can just say in Kubernetes, kubectl scale my deployment to more replicas. You saw earlier that I had this problem with the 5 of 3 during the rolling deployment because I only have one pod, and I can't really do a rolling deployment only with one pod. So let's maybe scale this up. Deployment, oh, sorry. yes. Okay. So down here, I'm just saying now, okay, I'm not going to do 400. So I'm just going to scale this up now, let's say, to 5 replicas. And let's see. And you see already, oh, this is like not, let's do it the other way around, like this. And you see now all these containers are automatically created without me having to do anything. And let's maybe do a bit of more information in this. So you also can see that it's automatically distributing it over different hosts. I have 3 nodes I showed you earlier, and it's distributing it over a different one of them. And here it's taking probably a bit longer because on this host it never ran before, and then it has on this host it actually has to download the image. That's why these are already up and running and this one is not. So this is like the manual way of doing it. And of course it's very nice to do if you know you're gonna have traffic before Christmas, or if you know you have a television spot running at 8 p.m., you can at 7:30 say, okay, just create a lot of more replicas, and then at 8:30 you can say, okay, remove them again because I don't want to pay for all this computational power. If you have a cloud provider that supports it, you also can not only scale easily pods, but also worker nodes. So for example, if we look, what I mean with that, if we look at this interface here, we can log in, I have my cluster here. Here, details. And I can easily just add nodes and then remove them afterwards again. Same as Google or Amazon. So you can do this manually, but what is even more interesting is to do this automatically. And for that, Kubernetes has a feature called horizontal pod autoscaling. And I have a different pod running already here, or a different deployment already running here, which is called Hello App. And let's see, let's have a look at the deployment here. Okay, what is actually inside? So what you see here, there is one container. This is the Nginx Hello World demo. And I'm exposing port 80 in this container. And here I'm having like a resource request defined. Where I'm saying, okay, this container should have at least like 0.1 CPU and 256 megabytes of memory. It probably doesn't make much sense to have this, but I put this in, put this fairly low and fairly strange so that I actually can emulate traffic easier. But you can define requests like this, and the scheduler will then schedule these pods only where there is CPU and memory available for free on the host so that you don't oversaturate hosts. The same way I could also put limits on here. So I could say this container is only supposed to get 512 megabytes of memory. If it gets more, Kubernetes will automatically kill the container. So also I have like an OM killer there directly included. I already have 2 replicas. You saw already 2 pods. And what I also created, I created a service here of the type load balancer that automatically gives this an external IP. So I can do something like, this is called something IP address, and I get the Hello World demo page back. And since this is not nice, let's just put this into the browser. Yeah. So I don't have a TLS certificate or anything, just to show you that I can reach it from the outside. Okay, next, I'm just going to copy the now from the documentation, I can configure an autoscaler. Okay, like this. So I can say, instead of QCDL scale the deployment Hello App, I say autoscale the deployment Hello App. And I want to have a minimum of one pod and a maximum of 6. And then I'm giving like a very small percentage of CPU usage when it already should autoscale it. So I'm going to, before I'm doing this, let's scale this down again. Let's scale this again back to 2. So it's, I scaled up the other deployment. Sorry. So I'm just going to create the autoscaler. The autoscaler actually is also just a resource in Kubernetes. So I can just say kubectl get oyaml. And I see, again, a YAML definition with the settings. So this is just a short way of creating this. I could also just put this into the YAML file and say kubectl apply. And now, let's first of all open a new window. And then say kubectl watch. So I have this here. I have one instance running, right? And now, instead of saying curl, I'm just putting an Apache benchmark next to it. And okay. So, what did I do wrong? Invalid URL. I think I need a slash at the end. Yeah. Okay. And hopefully, if I run this a few times, this is always the thing you don't know really if it works because there's so many things involved in there. Come on. Now it stopped working completely. Okay. Ideally, it should scale this up at some point.
You can increase the amount of requests.
Yeah, but also, let's increase this. And this is, maybe let's do not so much, maybe 500 and then like this. Usually it worked after running it a few times. Okay. Yeah, let's maybe do this if it doesn't work, I'm going to do this in an insane high number, and let's look in 2 minutes if it scaled up. Let's do it like this. So let's do it like this, and okay. I'm going to go back to the slides, and let's have a look later. So if you want to have more information on autoscaling and how it works internally, there is also documentation for that. So to sum this all up, Kubernetes is very powerful. It is very helpful that it solves a lot of the deployment and scaling headaches that I usually have if you have to do things manually. But it also makes, you have to learn it, of course. The development of Kubernetes is very fast-paced. There is a new release of Kubernetes that has lots of new features and bug fixes every 3 months. There is a minor patch update with bug fixes every month. That means if you run Kubernetes and you run it yourself, you should also keep up to date, because you want to do this because of bug fixes and everything, also because of it getting more performant, new features, and so on. Also means it is, of course, a bit of operational work. So keep up to date. The documentation of Kubernetes is really good. But again, since it's so powerful, it also takes some time to learn, OK, where is actually things, where they are placed. The documentation is there. And also what is really good is there is 2 conferences just about Kubernetes every year. They're really big nowadays. And the good thing is they record every talk, and they're available on YouTube after a few weeks. So this is a YouTube channel of the Cloud Native Foundation that runs these Kubernetes things. And I will publish the slides later on, OK? Or just search KubeCon on YouTube. That also works. Yeah. Yeah, short URL next time. I should put this in there. So I encourage you to go look there and watch. It's also 30 minutes talks usually, so they are very digestible. And the slides will be uploaded on SpeakerDeck and also going to tweet about it afterwards. So let's do a final check. Oh yeah, you see it scaled up. Good, with that, if you have any questions that you don't want to ask right now, you can send me an email or contact me over Twitter. And if you have anything that more complex that you want to ask about Kubernetes, please talk to me. If you're interested in someone to run Kubernetes for you, and if there's someone should be me, also talk to me. And if you are interested in actually running Kubernetes with me, also talk to me or Konstantin over there in the back, who can also answer you any questions for that if you're interested in working on Kubernetes full time. Thank you very much. And I think we can do 2-3 questions with the microphone, right?
Okay.
We have 5 minutes.
Raise your hands.
Oh. Yeah, so is this working?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. My question is, how do you run one-time CLIs for maintenance purposes or something like this?
Mm-hmm. I showed to you that you can create cron jobs, right, which do this regularly. You can also create a job that just does this once. So you can say kubectl create job, and then you have an image, same way as in a pod or a cron job, which just run a one-time CLI. Of course, it should finish at one point. Otherwise, it's probably not a good thing for a job. But yeah, you can do this once. And it also works fairly well and decides on its own where to run it, where there is space at the moment. Anything else? Yeah, in the back.
I'm just curious. You said like you run Kubernetes on the laptop, right?
Yes.
And you try to scale it, and you kind of get like 5 or 6 nodes running. So it means you're connected to some service, or
okay,
to some server, or it's running these 5 nodes running on your computer.
So
this is a bit.
Yeah. So I thought you. I said earlier you can run it on your laptop, but then you don't have a cluster. You just have one node, and I just open it. This is like the preferences of the Docker desktop client. You say you can then say enable Kubernetes, and then it will create a Kubernetes cluster with one node on your laptop. Yeah. What I am running here is actually on our SysElect MetaCube infrastructure. I'm running one Kubernetes cluster, which is also what you quickly saw here. Like this is the 3 nodes, they have external IP addresses. I can add a node easily here, and then it's going to be booted up in a few minutes.
Okay. Next question.
Yeah.
Can I ask next question? Yes, sorry, maybe it's a bit too amateurish, but
there's nothing too amateurish.
Yes. If I understand you correctly, after we are done with the whole, let's say, deployment, building the images, then Kubernetes is gone from the process, or Kubernetes is a layer on top of Docker?
Mm. So Kubernetes is not involved into building the images. So that I did locally on my machine. When I did this, I was in here in this directory. There is here the Docker file somewhere here, right? This is the whole source code, and if I say Docker build, I'm basically saying, create me a Docker image on my machine with this name, right? And when we run Docker images, you also see, yeah, somewhere they are in there. I'm having, yeah, here are some of the images, yeah, or here. So there are a couple that I'm building. And then what I can say is Docker push, and this will push this image to the public Docker hub, Docker registry. So there is this hub.docker.com that I'm using there. There are also other registries, and you see here under tags, this is like 37 minutes ago I built this image. And then what I'm telling my Kubernetes cluster, please fetch this image and run it somewhere. And this is what I'm doing with this deployment resource. So the one thing that Kubernetes is one thing that does the running of the image somewhere on some servers and manages that. And how this image is downloaded and when is it started, this whole thing is managed, but the building is I have to do somewhere before. Having said that, there is things that I can install in Kubernetes, something called, for example, Knative is a project where I can create a resource in Kubernetes that where I just reference my Git repository and it will listen on tags being created in the Git repository, and if there is a tag created, it in the Kubernetes cluster will build the image and then automatically trigger the deployment. So you can also build CI pipelines on Kubernetes. Yeah. Over here.
So in your demo, you disabled the pod at one point, and then you had that gateway error. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to kind of validate updates that you push? Because I think Kubernetes could have easily recognized that you're about to delete a pod that is actually required by the ingress service.
That's a very good question. Not that I'm aware of that you could. I don't think you can do this to prevent deletions of things that are referenced somewhere. Because the problem with that is also, what does reference mean? Of course, in this case, it could be easy because it's an ingress or a service referencing this pod. But maybe, what about if I delete a service and if it's used somewhere in application because that's using it, so it gets complicated then very quickly. So I don't know of a way how to do this.
Fair enough.
But that's what backups are for example, and restores. And monitoring in the end, so that also see there are 300s or 503s there that you're receiving.
Okay.
Okay, then enjoy lunch, and I'm going to be here the whole day, so grab me for questions.